But yeah, with that, why don't you just, start with just introducing yourself a bit, where you work, what do you do?
Sure. So, first of all, hello, all the folks who are listening to us, and it's great that you have been spared some time for the observability meetup out there on your Saturday morning. So, coming back to your question, Joy, I've been working with Razorpay for quite some time now, over 3 years, and it's been fun working over there. We have been working and solving most of the observability platform problems. Where we tend to solve how do we scale metrics, maybe scale traces and everything on scale. And that's where the talk will be revolving around on how do we probably solve all of the metrics problems at Razorpay using Victoria Metrics. We'll be discussing around what the go-to solution would be and what was the journey basically to actually reach to a point where we decided that, okay, we have to come use Victoria Metrics for scaling metrics at scale.
Cool. So I think, welcome, Vaibhav. And I see Piyush is also here. Piyush is our second speaker. He'll be speaking at the second session. Welcome. And, Vaibhav, thanks a lot for, agreeing to speak today. It should be a great talk going ahead. And we already have like around 10, 15 people watching on YouTube. So why don't you start with the whole conversation? So over and
Sure.
out to you. You can screencast.
Thank you, Jaya. Thanks a lot. I'm just screencasting. So, hello, folks. Once again, welcome. We will be talking about Victoria Metrics at scale today on the Observability Meetup for the March edition. I've already given a brief intro about myself. I'm working as a lead DevOps at Razorpay. I'll blog, try to blog a lot of things that usually come across as learnings to me. So you can always go and check out on my social media handles. Going forward, let's see what is the agenda of the today's approximately 1 hour, 50 minutes to 1 hour things. I'll be discussing about Prometheus, which is a well-known monitoring solution for any Kubernetes monitoring. Whenever you're moving towards a microservice model, you always see, and if you want to think about monitoring, you go towards Prometheus. We'll talk about possible solutions for what are the issues that comes up with Prometheus. Then we'll talk about the main handle of Victoria Metrics, how it works, what are all the components. Then we'll talk about what is scale that we are actually referring to here, right? We are not referring to any what is the scale that we'll be referring to. And the next most important question that comes around is that how much do you actually spend on the infrastructure? So we'll definitely have it. And then at the end of the session, we'll have some time for the questions that you'll be having in, and I'll try to solve it at the best I can. Okay, so metric solution. Everyone, like you're new to Kubernetes, you just Google around on things that, okay, I need to monitor my Kubernetes cluster. The first thing that you'll get out there is Prometheus, right? You get Prometheus out there to be the first bet of any continuous monitoring solution. And there are reasons why Prometheus is so popular out there in the community is because it is very easy to configure. You don't have to do a lot of juggling around if you're just starting off a bit, right? It's very easy configurations. And there are help charts available over there for installation, easy installation, there are Docker installations, everything is out there. So you have a very good variety of things. Then you have a lot of exporters available. So suppose if you want to if you want to monitor your node health, then you have node exporters out there. If you want to monitor your for Kubernetes cluster, you have KubeSat metrics, cAdvisor, and whatnot, right? Everything right now in this current industry or whatever is coming off is basically emitting metrics that are there within the Prometheus format. So it has a lot of exporters out there, and the community is moving towards it. And the last point is obvious right now because Prometheus has tend to want a lot of attraction, being the first one to solve the problem of monitoring. So Prometheus did gain an attraction. And like everyone else, we also thought of moving towards when we moved towards Kubernetes back there 3 years back, three and a half years back, we probably chose Prometheus as the monitoring solution that we have, like everyone else would have gone into, right? But things don't things changes with the scale, right? It's very easy to maintain a 10 node cluster, a 20 node cluster, but when you go at a scale of more than 100 node, 200 node, 300 nodes, then it becomes very difficult for you to manage, right? Because the scale actually changes a lot of things. And before I get into the issues of it, I'll just brief out on the basic architecture of Prometheus that we have. So if you see on the left side of this diagram, you have all your exporters and all your queue state metrics, node tree advisors and whatnot. Then this is the Prometheus server that we're talking about. So you have a Prometheus server that basically scrapes all these metrics endpoints via the configuration, whatever targets you have been configured to. And what it actually does is it basically does a curl call to HTTP endpoint on the slash metrics thing. It is the path and everything is configurable. So in general, the standard is slash metrics. So it goes to slash metrics, grabs the metrics and keeps it in its own local storage, which is a persistent volume storage that you see here. And then this is used by Grafana. This is all the metrics have been visualized by Grafana. And for alerting system and all that same, you have alert manager that they have broken into a different component. So you have alert manager, which basically does the job of notifying it to Slack or any of the webhooks that you can configure. So this is the basic architecture of how Prometheus looks like. Now let's talk about the issues and the problems, right? So I believe whoever are there in the system and who have been installed Prometheus for their monitoring infrastructure would be very familiar to a similar graph like this, like where you get the metrics till here, and then there's a broken metrics out here, and then your metrics again starts continuing. This is a very common scenario in when you use these kinds of things, is because Prometheus doesn't support HA by design. So Prometheus on its own on its own GitHub repo has and on the documentation have designed that by design will not go HA. So it has something called as a federation server, which kind of links to multiple small Prometheus servers that can happen, but it's not HA still. If your one Prometheus server is down, it's down. So this and that is the reason you see a lot of gaps in your metrics if you're not proper things off. Then there's a problem of long-term storage with the number of metrics that grew and your volume size keeps on increasing. And when your volume size keeps on increasing, whenever Prometheus restarts, the wall size increases and it takes a lot of time to come back up. So you'll find many issues out there at the Prometheus community as well to see that because of wall, it takes a lot of time to come back up. And then you have a single server for both scraping and visualization. What do you mean by this is that you have only one single point here, which is doing both of the jobs. You're scraping all these objects from here, and you're also helping with the queries that are coming via Grafana. Okay, let's continue. And then some of these things happens. So you these are nothing but issues that have been reported on the Prometheus open source repository, where you get out of memory errors, you get higher CPUs and targets cannot be scraped, and then you have a lot of things, right? So the reason of these is that when you increase the number of nodes or when you increase the number of targets, it keeps on happening on the same TSDB storage beneath it, right? It's a local storage and the local storage keeps on increasing. So whenever you are doing any queries or on top of it, it tends to use a lot of CPU, a lot of memory. And it is both intensive. So it'll start using the memory first and then your CPU will be blocked on the memory to respond. So all these things happen with Prometheus. Now, a similar thing happened with us at Razorpay. So we had a lot of downtimes on the monitoring infrastructure just because of these things, because your Prometheus was not stable enough. So we threw in hardware to solve the problem. But that was not the ultimate solution for the problem, right? So we started looking out for other alternatives towards Prometheus and how it can work. I'll probably touch base on the other problems like other solutions like Thanos and Cortex, and then we'll go deep dive into Prometheus. So Thanos is a very good was the first alternative that we chose off, and Thanos basically solves your long-term retention by using a remote backend called via S3 or something of that sort. But the problem with S3 native API is Thanos doesn't support directory structures within S3, and that's the main blocker, because S3's root structure, if you if you have multiple small objects, like over 10,000, 20,000 objects within the S3 bucket without any directory structures, then you're probably going into, then you are probably bad. It's become very difficult for you to do a S3 API call. And that's where your Thanos becomes a very bottleneck, because it doesn't have a solution of making directory structures on S3 yet. So the next thing came off with Cortex. Cortex on theory looks very good. It has all different components for different solutions, different problem statements. But the problem is that it's like, at least for us, it became too many moving components spoil the path, right? Too many cooks spoil the path. So the problem became out of there from Cortex, right? There are a lot of components, and it became very difficult to manage. And then we came off with Victoria metrics. We started evaluating with Victoria metrics. Now, I'll probably transform it with this picture. What happens is that your entire monitoring infrastructure with Prometheus is this big shaft that is on. And so it becomes a monolith kind of architecture, right? You are doing all the things at one single go. You are scraping it from the same server. You are basically computing your alerting rules from the same server. You are getting query, resulting to the queries on the same server. And it has become this big shaft. So what was required is to divide into multiple small cute fishes, which can probably solve their problems on their own one. So each one takes care of one. You don't have to, it's not necessary that one thing is going to take care of. That's what Victoria Metrics did at a very beginning, right? So it divided the things into three different parts. One is your storage and query, where you store data, query data. Second comes your scraping, and third comes your alerting. Now, within storage and querying also, since it's a very big part, it divided things into three different components, which is VM select, VM insert, and VM storage. I'll come to the detailed architecture, where VM select, VM insert, and VM storage. So what it basically tried to do is the similar thing that is pictorially represented here. It divided the whole big shark into small components that took care of their own respective things. So now, even if one component goes down, your other things still keeps on working. The other functionality still keeps on working. It doesn't have to matter where your one function goes down, and another also has to go down. And that's what the basic underlying architecture of microservices. Now, here we have Enter the Queen, which is Victoria Metrics, and this is the common architecture. So if you see out here, I'll talk about the storage and querying thing. So you have VM inserts, you have VM storage, and you have VM selects. And then you have your regular Prometheus for doing, you can have multiple agents for doing your scraping part of it. So what happens out here is you have Prometheus or InfluxDB or Graphite or OpenTSDB, anything of that sort becomes your agents. And this becomes your server model. Where VM insert, for if you want to insert the data into storage, then you have VM insert. So this is the basically edge point between your agents, entry points for your agents to writing data on your storage. This the VM storage one is the central layer where all your data resides. So what it does is it takes data from VM insert, it writes data to disk, and it keeps things in buffer as well. So what happens is till the time insert comes off, insert takes off the data from the VM storage, takes the data from VM insert, keeps it off, and writes it. And so this is how your storage work only happens. So now your insert doesn't have to wait a lot. Then VM select is the one that is helping you to query the data. So whenever from Grafana you are hitting, suppose you are querying any PromQL, then what happens is VM select interacts with VM storage and displays off with the data. So this is how you basically go on and keep on segregating the value, right? So let's talk about the statefulness of the component. The only stateful component out there in the entire architecture is VM storage box, where your actual data resides on. Right? You can have PVs attached towards on your VM storage pods, and then that will keep on writing on that data. And now the best, even within the stateful components, it's not a single point of failure. So what it's a distributed system. You can have replications configured towards it so that your data is not only on a single disk or a single node, And even if a node goes down, you still have other nodes to actually serve the data, right? So this is on the server side of it. So I'll probably summarize the points again. So all the entire component in that thing is very simple. You don't have to mingle around with the configurations. And that's the best DRP that Victoria Matrix is kind of saying. So you come, you just take the Victoria Matrix in a clustered object and you deploy it. You don't have to mingle around with many configurations and everything goes smoothly. Then you have clear separation between writes and reads, as I've already mentioned. So the writes are taken care via VM inserts. So VM inserts are basically doing the write towards the VM storage. And the reads, whatever are coming from Grafana, are coming from VM server. Now think of a scenario where your VM inserts are down. All your VM inserts are down, or you make the replicas as zero, right? But still you'll be able to query the older data. It's why, because your VM select and VM storage are up. So it's not like you're denying the capability of querying the older data. And by the time your VM inserts are coming up, it'll again start off buffering it to the VM storage. You don't lose data. The only catch here comes is that the timestamp starts differing when your VM insert goes down suddenly. So how does it work is because any remote API actually keeps things in buffer, and it how especially with Prometheus and everything, how it works is you're still keeping Prometheus. At this moment, you're still keeping Prometheus as a scraping layer, right? So Prometheus scrapes the layer and it uses the remote write API of Prometheus itself to write it to VM insert. Now, once it's writing it to VM insert, it keeps, there's something called as a write ahead lock, a wall. It works on a wall mechanism, and it keeps a track on how much time data it has already written. And then it keeps things in buffer. So whatever is the wall retention rate would be your time duration that you can probably afford to make your VM insert down. But that's not always adjustable. And obviously, and it's not something that we'll want to, right? And again, all your VM inserts, your VM selects, everything is stateless. It can scale independently, infinitely, and whatnot. So you runs from default configuration, no extra fills is required, storage, ingestion, read, everything is there. And the best DRP again that comes again from Victoria Matrix on the storage side is it does higher compression. So what effectively it means is that if suppose you are using 1 terabyte of disk space with regular Prometheus, Victoria Matrix can store the same data in around 300 GBs. And that's what is the best part of it, right? That the compression that it does is too great. The highlights, some of the highlights is that you don't have to change anything on your when you're exposing any metrics, or your applications doesn't have to change, your exporters doesn't have to change, everything is supported. All your Prometheus thing is supported, right? And from the Grafana side also, you don't have to add another data source of that sort. You just have to change the endpoint and point it to the VM select pods or the VM select load balancer, and you're done. So you don't have to change anything on apart from that, right? It supports many other agents. Apart from Prometheus, it supports many other agents like Graphite, JSON, InfluxDB, and whatnot. You can even insert it via normal call. It's VM, so we distributed with replication factor, as I've already mentioned, that VM storage is distributed with multiple replication factors. So you can have 5 nodes with a replication factor of 3. So your data is at your same data is there at the three different nodes. Now the question will arise: if my data is at the 3 different nodes, how does it a deduplication factor? Right, it has to do a dedupe, and it has a dedupe built in. So it has a dedupe called as dedupe main step interval. Now this deduplication happens at 2 layers. One is at the querying layer. This is what I said, because of the replication factor, it takes your internal. What happens is, suppose now Prometheus didn't support it HA by default. So what I have to do is you have to run 2 different Prometheus pods, scraping the same data. Now, if you're scraping the same data and pushing out to the same Victoria Matrix, the Victoria Matrix on the VM insert layer has a problem, because now it has 2 similar metrics at similar timestamps. Now this is not possible, right? And this is why you have a feature called as dedupe min scrape interval, which basically means that it will check the timestamps of it. It will check that, okay, 2 metrics are there, which are similar to each other. And what will happen is it will match the timestamps. If the timestamp is less than this particular configuration, then what will happen is it will drop one of the metrics and store only one of them. only one metric component. So this way it does a deduplication factor as well. And it also supports multi-tenancy. So there are multiple organizations which has multiple teams, multiple business units and whatnot, right? So you can, and if you want to do segregations within the business units, within the teams, within the project IDs, you can do them via multi-tenancy support, which via using namespaces or tenants. So till now, what we have done is we have taken care of the storage side of it and the querying side of it. So now our storage is sorted and our querying is sorted, right? You query it with a different component, it stores it with a different component. But we haven't replaced the agent yet. Our agent for scraping things is still the Prometheus itself, right? So what happens is that Prometheus, even if it's scraping a lot of targets, when I talk about a lot of targets, suppose you have a microservice that runs around 50, 60 pods. And it is monitoring, Prometheus is monitoring hundreds of these kinds of microservices which are running all these number of pods. Then what happens is your number of metrics, individual metrics keeps on increasing. And once it keeps on increasing, Prometheus, even on scraping, takes a lot of memory and a CPU, basically takes a lot of resources. So it becomes very difficult to manage post one pod, right? So that is where you can replace Prometheus with VM agent. Now, what VM agent does is it is a direct replacement of Prometheus. You don't have to change any of your configurations. You don't have to change any of your exporters. You don't have to change anything. You just replace Prometheus with VM agent and it works like anything. It works smoothly, right? So the reasons why we have to replace Prometheus with that is because Prometheus is a resource, as we have already seen, right, in the previous issues as well. There are multiple such issues that have been reported because of resource heaviness of Prometheus and Prometheus going out of memory, it's been crashing and all that stuff. There was one scenario that we faced a lot of time when the number of metrics increases was wall corruptions. And Prometheus, if you go towards the Prometheus documentation, it itself says that when you're doing a remote write feature or a remote read feature of Prometheus, what happens is that it starts taking double or triple the memory of what it will take without a remote write feature, right? And since if you want to use from Victoria Metrics as a server, it becomes very difficult because it kind of utilizes the remote write functionality. And that means a lot of wall corruptions, a lot of even more memory utilization, and hence the cost associated with it. There have been what happens is that there have been delays in pushing metrics as well at some equations where you get network chokes and things of that sort. VM agent, on the other hand, was very lightweight. It uses like I'll give you a scenario when we are using Prometheus for scraping for multiple tasks. We had to spend we have to have 8 or 9 different nodes on which all your Prometheus were there, just because there were multiple business units and everything. So 9 different nodes you were having Prometheus. When we replaced it with VM agent, only 2 or 3 nodes were more than enough for it. It was like, even then we have to reduce the instance type for making them, so that because the resources are not being used. So this is the amount of resource consumption difference that we're talking about, right? It's 3x or 4x of the difference. It's Prometheus compatible, so it can directly integrate with all of your exporters and everything. It's stateless. As we have already seen that Victoria Metrics is storing data on the VM storage layer. So there's no storage that you have to do basically on your VM agent layer. Right, so it's stateless. So you can have n number of replicas for a single object, and then you can have deduplication supported on your insert, so that none of your data is deduplicated. And then you get rid of that gaps that you get in the graph that I've shown earlier. Right. Then comes VM alert. So Prometheus again, as I've mentioned earlier here in this part. Is you divide things into 3 different components. So we divide things into storage and querying, we divide things into scraping, and then the third part is alerting. So we have already discussed about how storage looks like, how querying looks like, how do we scrape it via VM agent. And then now the last part comes off to alerting, which was still handled at the Prometheus layer for this, right? So what happens is that this is replaced by a component called as VM alert. What it does is it basically computes all your alerting rules, and based on the alerting rules, it sends a signal to alert manager, which basically in turn sends your notifications to your Slack channel or something like that. And then you can within the alerting rules, you can configure different types of taggings, different type of you want to have run book URL, you have to run your Grafana URL and whatnot, right? Everything can be configured over there. So VM alert is basically evaluates the alert against Victoria metrics and will send the firing alerts to alert managers, right? Cool. Let's talk about scale, right? What scale are we referring to? So what we are referring to is 2.793 trillion data points at any given point of time, right? So that is a amount of data points that if you do any single query, that is the amount of data points that it has to basically query back and see that, okay, what is happening and give you back the exact results, right? And our data points are growing with a rate of 958,000 every second. So every second, these are the number of data points that are extra added to the server, right? And each data point has a byte of 3.33 bytes, every data point. Now the best part is that even with this much of our data, you have only 782 gigabytes of storage that is stored. Now note that this storage is across 5 different VM storage pods and with a replication factor of 3. So that means this entire storage is actually thrice of the compressed data, right? So what happens is you have a replication factor of 3. So that is the level of compression that Victoria Metrics supports, and it saves a lot of disk space. And whether you talk about any storage type, right? Whether you talk about EC2, SSD, or anything of that sort, right? They're still disks, they're not RAM, right? And with that means it is slow. So if you have a lot of data on your file descriptors, if you read a lot of data via your file descriptors, then definitely if that will slow down with the amount of data that you have. And we are making network calls for sure. Now, this is something that will fascinate a lot of engineers and would have, like every company wants to save cost, right? It's not every penny is hard earned, right? So you have to save that thing, and there have been costing meetings in almost all of your organization. Now, how much do we spend for this entire infrastructure, right? You have the best part about VM select, VM insert, VM alert, everything is stateless. So that gives us the flexibility to run them on spot nodes. So we run all these components on 100% spot nodes with a variety of spot instances and with HPA enabled. So our minimum configuration is you have only 2 pods running at any off-peak hours. And based on the load, if suppose a person is querying a lot, more people are querying in the daytime, right? More people will be opening your dashboards at the daytime during office hours, right? So that time, what will happen is the HPA will trigger in, will scale up your VM select nodes, VM select pods. And that's how it happens. And since everything runs on spot, it hardly makes a price difference. The only component that runs on demand is VM storage, is because it's stateful. Although it still can run on some percentage of spot, it depends on the how your spot architecture looks like. So I'm assuming that we are having 5 VM storage nodes with all on-demand instances, then we are spending around $13 a day. With 3 spot nodes for all the other components, that too is also based on if you want to leave headrooms towards other components or other pods to come in and stay back, and for HA kind of thing, you don't want an EC2 instance to go down and keep off, and you will hardly spend a $3 on top. And then suppose you are having HA on your VM agent pods for scraping things off, then also the requirements is around 500 MBs and 10 millicores. So this is the requirement of scraping things off, which even I didn't get a proper like instance for that particular kind of thing since you did not use T2L. Still, I've taken accounted $2 max to max mark over there. So the total spend of supporting these many number of targets, these many number of data points, the trillions data points, you are spending only less than $18 a day, which is very nice. And you don't compromise on availability on top of it. So it's whenever we talk about cost, everyone says that cost is availability will take a hit if you talk about a lot about cost. Right? So that's not the case here. What we have done is we have made each and every component as HA. We have decided that we have having multiple replication factors, everything, right? You have replications across your data storage nodes. You have multiple VM inserts. You have multiple VM selects. You have HA on the VM agent pods here. And with all those also, you're spending only a fraction of amount. What you will have been spending with the same amount of data, same amount of querying, will be spending a lot more on a vanilla Prometheus architecture. Or even if you talk about Thanos, if you talk about Cortex, it takes a lot because of the complexities of the architecture that starts building. I've attached some of the references on the things. So there's been very good blog on Medium for a comparison between a vanilla Prometheus Victoria Metrics benchmarking. And it also talks about Thanos and Cortex under the hood as well. So do check out this blog. It probably shows you with proper metrics on storage, your memory, your CPU, and all your consumption that it is 7x times better. And this is a claim on their own on their website as well, and on their documentation that via this benchmarking, they have proved that it's 7 times faster than that. And apart from, so whenever we read such statements, right, we feel like it cannot be true because when you're actually implementing it out your own infrastructure, it tends to differ based on your hardware that you're using, based on the architecture that you're using, based on the metrics that you're exposing. But out of my personal experience as well, VM agent have, or VM Victoria metrics as a whole on all the components have done us very well. And it probably has actually proved that it is one of the lightest component that is available for the monitoring infrastructure. I'm pretty much done with my things. I'll leave the next 5-10 minutes out there if you have any questions.
Cool. Thank you, Vaibha, for giving such a wonderful talk, a very concise talk on Victoria Metrics and its benefits or comparisons over other toolkits. Thank you for coming here and talking about it. So we have some audiences both on YouTube live stream and here on the Zoom call. If anyone would like to now pose a question or maybe a couple of questions, you can unmute yourself and then start asking Vaibha something that's relevant to the talk he just presented. So yeah. So I see some folks here. I see Srikant, Rakhi, Avinash. Any of you would have any questions around the current talk, you can unmute yourself and ask Vaibha directly. I'm sure he'll try and answer most of your queries.
If nobody else, I have a question.
Hey, Ankit, hi. Why don't you go ahead?
I wanted to ask you, how much time does it usually take to set up the complete components for running Prometheus and getting things up and running for monitoring? And which are the most time-taking components? Because the concerns people have, apart from running Prometheus, is like it takes them 1.5 months to set things up, right? So I would like to know how much time did you take and which components were the most time-taking, and if there is anything that could be improved to cut those time out.
Sure. Thanks for the question. So there have been a lot of things when you talk about you're setting a monitoring infrastructure and it takes around 1 month and 1.5 months, right? So there have been a lot of considerations that folks generally make while making this decision. If you talk about a vanilla setup of Victoria Matrix and all the Victoria Matrix agent and everything, it probably takes a couple of hours, not more than that, to actually set up the entire architecture. What actually takes a lot of time is to understand that. So when you're doing a Helm install from that, using the Helm chart of Victoria Matrix, right? when you install all those components, what generally happens is it installs the Nginx servers on top of Nginx pod as well. So it takes good amount of time to understand, okay, what is your organization ID and what is the endpoint that with which will insert, do a remote write or a remote read from Grafana. Right? So that is one point that the first point that you can search it on the documentation. The documentation is pretty good. It's decent enough to have all your details. And it will not take more than a couple of hours or maximum a day to set up the entire architecture, right? Whatever we have discussed over here.
Okay. So what about scaling things up, like reaching a scale that a normal organization can use? Capacity planning one of the time-taking things, or is exporting metrics one of the time-taking things? Any other stuff that consume time? I would not say that a couple of hours is the total time it takes for an organization to grow from zero to having monitoring setup, right?
Correct.
So what are the components there, and what are the time-consuming time things there?
Sure. So for capacity planning, what Victoria Matrix has is, okay. Victoria Matrix has some very good thing on with reference to your capacity planning. It completely says that, okay, how much data that you emit and all. But for any startup organization, it becomes very difficult to understand that, okay, how much metrics I'll be emitting, right?
Right.
It took us considerable amount of time also to say that, okay, we are emitting these many metrics, and this is the granularity at which we are emitting metrics. So that obviously keep that there's no straightforward formula for getting those things. It's about how do you keep on tracking things, and you increase scale. You scale as you go, kind of thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's not you'll throw off petabytes of data in a single grow in a single shot, right? You'll grow individually, and what you'll have to grow is within Victoria Matrix. If you say is that you'll have the only component that you have to take care of growing horizontally is your VM storage node. Which has some hassles, because if you're increasing another node of VM storage, you'll have to add that node on VM insert and VM select as well. Okay. That is one mistake that we did during our setup. So there was a scale. We were actually hitting scale, and we were having resource crunches over there. Our storage nodes were not responding properly. So we did increase the storage nodes, but we didn't added that those nodes address on your select and your insert node.
Okay.
And this is after some debugging and all, we got to know that, okay, this is something that you'll have to keep note of, because VM inserts and VM select doesn't kind of does a service discovery, and it doesn't use a service model to actually identify all your storage nodes. Okay. But you have to explicitly provide them with a cross DNS entry resolution for that via headless service.
Cool. That was interesting.
So sort of a corollary to what Ankit asked, like what happens on bursty workloads? What happens if tomorrow you release a new service and this particular service suddenly starts seeing a very, very large amount of traffic, let's say. How does VM storage scale when suddenly you go from 3.3 billion events to double that, maybe over the span of a day? Would the storage handle that sort of bursty load, or would it start dropping samples and, you know, suddenly you have a lot of blank canvas to deal with, right? So what happens in that scenario?
So what happens in this kind of scenario is that you have a component above your storage nodes, right, on both your querying layer and your inserting layer. So what we are kind of expecting with this question is on the insert side of things. So you have an insert node. So what insert pods does, it keeps off a buffer between sending it to storage nodes, right? So it keeps things on buffer. Now the drawback of this this particular scenario would be that whenever you're querying data on your VM storage nodes via VM select, you'll obviously get, you'll be getting a differences in your amount of data that you're getting. So the timestamp. So suppose the last, if it's double the thing and if your VM storage is not able to handle that part or it's writing very slow, then what will happen is you'll start missing your last 5 minutes of data, and then you'll see all your data. So it'll take some time to actually fill back that data. But no, none of the component will go down directly. And because VM insert will take care of keeping things in buffer, and it'll only throw off, it'll act as a queuing system, you can say that. So think of it as a Kafka queue or any queue where you keep on pushing messages, and it basically pops off the message as in when the consumer is allowed to, is healthy enough to take that messages. Now, but that definitely comes with a drawback on that part. If that load is too extensive and it's out of things, the VM selects will not be able to see you the recent most data that you are expecting out of a query. That's the only drawback.
Cool. Yeah, I think that answers most of what I sort of tried to ask. But I still see in real life, mm-hmm. there could be situations where things and but like you can always capacity plan of a new service to a certain extent, but real world events always go askew of most of our best laid plans, right?
Exactly.
Real world scales are always so different than what we can mm-hmm. plan for.
Exactly.
But still, we can, at least knowing the way this workload has been laid out, we can have some plan which sort of answers, if I was doing this, how would I want to sort of handle this, right?
Mm-hmm.